Attention back. We've got a couple panelists with hard deadlines and trains to catch. So I think this is a really interesting, I should say, I'm Kara Miller, the host of Innovation Hub, for those of you that I haven't met, a radio show that airs across the country. And this is a fascinating panel, I think, as the follow-up to the first panel, because the first panel was, you know, really talking about our relationship with nature. And I think, you know, in looking at the future of work, which is what we're going to do with the second panel, we're looking at some of the things that enable people to have the time and space to look up, to make sure that their sort of day-to-day needs are met, i.e. they have work to do, and to look up then and look at the world around them. And we've seen in the last year or two, this discussion of what's more important, sort of the natural world and the planet or people's day-to-day needs. Well, these things obviously cannot be mutually exclusive, but in having this discussion about where jobs are going and where work is going, I think this goes hand in hand with the question about where the planet is going. They're interrelated, and they both are things that people have to grapple with. So let me first hand it off to Andrew McAfee, who was first on Innovation Hub when it was a baby program 6 years ago. And we've had him on periodically since then. And the first time he and his co-author, Eric Brynjolfsson, spoke to me about the automation of jobs and how things were dramatically changing, it was really the first time that I had ever heard anybody talk about that. Now, that's really become a strain of sort of mainstream conversation. But how we deal with it, I don't know that we've fully figured out or grappled with. So let me turn it over to Andy.
Kara, thanks. I am the guy with a train to catch. What that means is I'm going to talk very quickly. I thought a way to talk about some of the research that we've been conducting and that I've become aware of is to put it in a form that a lot of us are familiar with, just a fact or frequently asked questions about what's going on with jobs and wages, concentrating on the American economy. So the first one, okay, what is going on? The simple, slightly oversimplified, but hopefully not unhelpfully oversimplified answer is what we're seeing is a real polarization in the U.S. workforce. And I want to draw a picture that gets the point across as clearly as anything I've ever seen about what has been happening in the U.S. workforce. And it comes from my MIT colleague, David Autor, who just has been diving in on trends in the American workforce for quite a while, recently has turned his attention to the impact of technology and automation and things. And as part of this work, he drew my favorite picture about what's been happening over the course of a couple decades to the American workforce. I want to redraw that picture a little bit different. So what David did in that paper was he lined up all the jobs that existed in the US in about 1980, in 1979. He put the lowest paid ones down at close to the axis, highest paid in the middle, and then right there is that good old-fashioned American middle class. And I think we would all agree that the large, stable, prosperous American middle class is one of the shining achievements of our society, is really a healthy thing for a healthy democracy. And that what David did then was he played the tape forward, and he watched at where the jobs were being gained and being lost from 1979 forward. Not in absolute numbers, it's not about overall job growth, it's about the market share of jobs. So for example, looking at the period 79 to 89, he drew a line that looks like this. And what you should conclude from that is that the market share of all of these jobs declined. There were proportionally fewer of those kinds of jobs over the course of that 10-year period, and there are proportionally more of these kinds of jobs by 1989. This is a really good news picture. What this shows is that the economy was net losing low-paid jobs and net creating high-paid jobs. So after that 10-year period, the American workforce had more highly paid workers and fewer very low-paid workers. So this is awesome. And then where things start to get challenging is when we continue to play the movie forward and look at later time periods. So here's 79 to 89. Here's what happened 89 to 99. And you see that worrying kind of jump way down low in some of the lousiest jobs in the country, and we're tailing off a little bit in that middle class. From 99 to 2007, things got very, very different. We created a lot of lower middle class, even low class jobs in the country. The rest of it just kind of flatlined, and you start to see this worrying trend in the middle where we're losing jobs right there in that historically large, stable, prosperous American middle class. I wish I could tell you that in the most recent years the situation reversed. That's not what happened. You see this real hollowing out of the workforce. We continue to create lots of relatively lousy, low-paid jobs. And then you see the rise of the upper middle class and certainly the 1% way up top. This is a very good time to be a data scientist or a user experience designer. It's a challenging time to be right there in that historical middle class. So a couple questions come up after this. Number one, is this happening only in the United States or is it a global phenomenon? This is a rich world phenomenon. It's very broad based. I want to draw a picture that shows the same phenomenon presented in a different way. Each of these groups of three columns is a different rich world country. And what they're doing here is looking at where the jobs were created and lost from 1993 to 2010. And the phenomenon is incredibly consistent. The jobs are being lost right there in the middle class, rich country after rich country after rich country. So then the next question is, okay, why is this happening so broadly? One answer you hear a lot is all the jobs are being shipped overseas. And there is some truth to that. Globalization has changed the workforce pretty dramatically. But it's not the full story at all. And I actually think it's a distraction from the bigger story. My favorite way to show this is to look at what's been happening in U.S. manufacturing. And we hear a lot about the crisis in U.S. manufacturing. We should be clear, the crisis in U.S. manufacturing is not a crisis about the size of the industry. The U.S. is a manufacturing powerhouse, and this is how big our total manufacturing industries are over time. You see really healthy growth, with the exception of recessions. The crisis is an employment crisis because this red line is what's been happening to total employment in U.S. manufacturing. While output has been rising, while we're generating more and more manufactured stuff, we're very clearly doing it with fewer and fewer people over time. This cannot be a globalization story. This is all about what's happening domestically. It's a technology and automation and productivity story. We're seeing the story crop up more and more often. So then this gets to the deeper issue. Okay, what actually is going on? I want to quote David Auder and one of his colleagues again, because I see technology under every rock. It's just as a result of the work that I've been doing. David doesn't. So when he sees technology, I take it very, very seriously. And what he concluded from a separate piece of research was, look, the American middle class was built on the back of routine work. And you can think of routine physical work, that's an assembly line worker in a factory, or you can think about routine cognitive work, that's the payroll clerk inside that same factory. We created a lot of middle class jobs doing routine work, and now we have technology, both hardware and software, robots and software, that do that routine work better, cheaper, faster, higher quality than the people do. So we should expect this big substitution to take place. And when we look at other factors, They don't add up to very much. This is a story about the automation of routine work throughout the rich world. And the question that comes up, if you believe that, is, okay, well, then why don't we have mass unemployment in America? We have been generating jobs, without exception, month by month for 85 months since the end of the recession in America. If the story about mass displacement because of automation is true, shouldn't we be seeing the unemployment rate go up? And the reason we're not is kind of twofold. If you have economic growth, if the economy grows overall, and you have flexible labor force, so people can move pretty easily from one job to another, then you don't get unemployment. So this is what's been happening. The top line is just the raw GDP, just the size of the economy. And that bottom line, the orange line, is just how many raw jobs there are in America. You see these go up in lockstep. If you want to create jobs, grow the economy. That relationship is just incredibly tight. And the United States has a very flexible labor force. We have relatively a fluid workforce. It's easy to hire and fire people. So we have the most flexible labor force in the rich world. What it means, though, is that this is the kind of thing that happens. The way our flexibility has been manifesting itself, again, to repeat ourselves, we're losing jobs in the middle, and they're shifting a little bit up. That's great news. In general, they're shifting down. A follow-up point, there actually is concentrated mass unemployment in the United States. The thing that we need to keep in mind about the unemployment rate, the way we calculate it, is that you're only included in that calculation if you're either in work or looking for work. If you're completely on the sidelines of the economy, if you have checked out for any set of reasons, you're not counted in the unemployment calculation. So in a sense, it's painting a little bit too rosy a picture. When we look at prime age American men, we're seeing this crazy phenomenon, which is that the percentage of people who are in the workforce, they're either employed or they're looking to get employed, has been dropping off very, very steadily for kind of a while. And that drop off does not show any real signs of leveling off. Like a lot of us can imagine, if you unpack that blue line a little bit, you see that it's very highly concentrated among our least educated workers. There's been very little drop-off among college-educated and above male workers in the United States. But when you get down below that, you really start to see many, many people dropping off and sitting on the sidelines of the economy. So a follow-up question there is, if the story makes sense so far, what are the consequences, what are the implications of this? And I want to say one thing very, very carefully. All the evidence I'm going to show about the consequences comes from many, many sources. The social scientists talk about causal density. What they mean by that is important phenomena have many, many different causes. So what I don't want to say is the decline in labor force participation or the hollowing out of middle class jobs is directly and only responsible for the things that we're going to talk about in a second. I just want to say it's part of the situation that's unfolding. So it's hard to say exactly what the causes are. There are a few other things that are going on. In general, I don't find them good news. We have heard by now about those strange increases in mortality and death rates among particularly white middle-aged Americans. The mortality rates, the death rates for almost every demographic group are going down. This is really, really good news for public health, with the exception of, at first we were focused on white middle-aged Americans, now it's broadened out, and this is the opioid epidemic story, which by now has been responsible for more deaths than the AIDS epidemic and is now the leading cause of death for Americans under 50. This is a huge public health crisis. And again, I don't want to say that prime age unemployment is the only cause of the opioid epidemic. I think it's got to be in the mix of causes here. The other thing that we're seeing, and this is work that Charles Murray has been leading the way on, are different measures of what happens to these communities that are most likely to have work going away. So Murray talks about these two kind of fictional towns, Belmont, which is an upper middle class American community. They kind of think about the top 20% of the American middle class, and then some of us are probably from Belmont, right? And then Fishtown, which is his archetypal lower middle class community in the United States. And what he's documented is how 50 years ago, the social situation in Belmont and Fishtown was very, very close to each other. These were socially very similar places. And over the past half century or so, they've become very dissimilar places. So there are many fewer nuclear families intact in Fishtown than was the case. Belmont hasn't changed very much at all. The percentage of kids being raised in two-parent homes is well below 50% in Fishtown. The needle has hardly moved in Belmont. The incarceration rates have skyrocketed in Fishtown, haven't budged very much at all in Belmont. And another cause that I can point to pretty clearly is what Catherine Kramer calls the politics of resentment. She went to these rural communities in Wisconsin. Before the 2016 election, she was trying to understand the Scott Walker phenomenon. And talk to the people there, and she just came away with this sense that they were just resentful of more educated people, professional people, upper middle class people, and the sense that they had really started to disentangle from each other. I turn this into a caution. When I talk to my friends in Silicon Valley, some of them were worried about the Terminator scenario or about big scary AI, and the caution that I always give them is, gang, if these trends continue, the people are going to rise up way before the machines do. I don't have to look too hard to find evidence of some popular uprisings that are a little bit challenging to me. Here are Donald Trump and Nigel Farage, the leaders of, or the winners of the 2016 election and the Brexit phenomenon in the United Kingdom. So these politics of resentment are manifesting themselves pretty clearly in my eyes. And then finally, you know, is this situation going to get better? And there's this fascinating divergence of opinion among the smartest people that I get to talk to about this. Some say, look, we have seen this movie before. Big technology changes bring big workforce changes. They're temporary. And the genius of the free market system is that it grows, and then that growth brings with it new companies, new industries, new job opportunities. We need to tweak some things, clearly. But if we let this relentless engine do what it has been doing for 200 years, we'll get the same pattern we've had for 200 years, which is steadily rising wages, low unemployment, really good prosperity. So that's the view that things are going to get better. I talk to other people equally convinced that this time is actually different, and that the wave of technology and automation that we have now is qualitatively different. When we have machines that can listen to us and detect patterns better than we can and learn to play games like poker and Go, games that we invented, better than we do and become the world champions at them, this is actually kind of a new era. So the historical precedent actually doesn't mean that much. I don't know which of those is accurate. Maybe we'll get a chance to talk about that. The last thing I want to, the question I want to cover is, okay, given that these things are going on, what should our intervention set look like? What's the policy playbook look like? And it depends a lot on who you talk to. So I want to draw you a spectacularly unscientific and subjective Venn diagram of who agrees on what about what to do here. So I'm dividing this arbitrarily into three groups. It depends on if you talk to economists, if you talk to technologists, and if you talk to politicians. Politicians, some of them these days, think a trade war will be an answer here. No economists believe that, none of the technologists I talk to. Some people think that raising a minimum wage would be a smart thing to do. Some people think that lowering income taxes will magically spur middle-class prosperity by mechanisms that kind of elude me. You get a bit more agreement on whether or not we should be increasing the negative income tax and subsidizing the wages of low-income people. I have a lot of technologist friends who are really fond of this idea of just giving money to everybody. I'm not fond of that idea for reasons that we can talk about. Economists and technologists love reforming burdensome regulations and having a more liberal immigration policy. And then, you know, in the happy part of the Venn diagram, most reasonable people agree that an infrastructure upgrade would be a pretty healthy thing to do. And there's probably the broadest agreement is that we should reform our educational system. I think we're doing a great job of turning out the kinds of workers we needed 70 years ago. That's a really inappropriate thing to be doing now. So let me stop there. I hope I didn't talk too quickly, and we'll get a chance to talk some more during the panel discussion.
Stay here for a second. That was great. That was exactly quick enough, and I look forward to talking with everybody. I'm going to ask you one real quick question. I was talking to somebody recently about the Chinese educational system,
yeah,
which is very test-based. People drop out at all different points along the way. Millions of kids drop out. And one of the things she said is, we see problems, though, because it used to be that the kids who dropped out got manufacturing jobs, oh, yeah, but they're all moving to Bangladesh. So we're a little concerned about popular discontent in the countryside, which is where a lot of people, you know, are who take those manufacturing jobs. You mentioned Nigel Farage. Do you see this as a bigger than America issue?
Oh, yeah. To be clear, I would rather have our bundle of challenges than anyone else's bundle of challenges. I don't mean to minimize the challenges that we have. When I think about the cost declines of Moore's Law hitting rising Chinese wage rates, ooh, that's going to be an unpleasant collision, and that's going to happen in the not crazy distant future. Mm-hmm. So I would rather have, you know, even with the flaws in our educational system and our infrastructure and our policies, I would rather have our bundle of problems.
Thank you so much.
Thanks.
Thank you. So I'm going to turn it over to Pollock Shaw now. If there is one area where there is going to be an explosion of work, it is domestic workers. But how we deal with that and how we think about that kind of work is a challenge unto itself. So here you go. Thank you so much.
Many smart people, like Andy, tell me that this is the future of transportation. Cars that are programmed to obey the rules of the road, cars that get you home safely after a night of drinking and partying, Cars that talk to other cars, safely maneuvering out of the way if one has a brake failure. Efficient and smart. Why then does this picture make us feel so uneasy? I think it's because we have no idea who is driving this thing. How does the car decide what to do when faced with a suboptimal choice? Will it brake, risking injury to you, or crash into a woman stepping into the crosswalk? Is it a different decision if she's jaywalking? Does the decision change if facial recognition software tells the car that the woman is a Nobel Prize-winning scientist on the verge of a breakthrough, while it knows that you're just out to pick up weed? In all seriousness, a decision must be made. And someone is making that decision, whether a driver behind the wheel or an algorithm determining the best outcome. So who are we trusting to make these decisions? It's easy to hide behind the excuse, well, it's the software, or an algorithm calculated the outcome. But the truth is, technology is created by us, people. Every driverless car does have a driver, presumably someone sitting somewhere in the world who programmed the safety features and response functionality. But we have no transparency into this. We can't see the person who created the software, and we can't see what rules it uses. Whose values are these decisions based on? What are the product specs? There's simply no way to look under the hood. We don't know how this works, who it's working for, and how it will change the industry. And the way things are going right now, we also have no say or control. This is exactly what's happening with the future of work. Click by click, work is being transformed by technology. Labor markets are moving online, so it's easier to find the right person for the right job at the right price. Mobile technology enables us to work anywhere and anytime. Complex algorithms are connecting gigs with gig seekers in just a matter of seconds. Online rating systems make it easier to choose workers by showing you how they fared with previous customers. This is quickly becoming the future of work, efficient and smart. Sound familiar? I am the Social Innovations Director of the National Domestic Workers Alliance, the leading voice for the nation's 3 million women who care for our most precious assets. My hope today is to give you all a window into a world where the future of work is going, by inviting you into our invisible world. It's an undervalued world, one in the shadows for generations that technology is rapidly disrupting and dramatically changing. Pulling back the curtain on these disruptions can shed light on where we are headed when the economy is driven by technology, and what we can do together to ensure that the future of work is incubating opportunity instead of accelerating inequality. Every morning, two separate workforces head in opposite directions. One group, the larger and formal workforce of around 100 million, leave their homes for workplaces, an office, a worksite, a studio. The other, a smaller, mostly female and more informal workforce of millions, leaves its homes for the homes of others. They are the nannies that comfort the colicky baby, the caregivers who diffuse the panic attack of a disoriented grandparent, and cleaners who keep our homes neat and tidy. They are nurse, therapist, cook, and companion, all at the same time, and yet they're often told what they do is not real work. Domestic work in this country is rooted in the ugly legacy of slavery. The invisible work of cleaning, washing laundry, taking care of children has always been undervalued and underpaid, when paid at all. In the 1930s, Congress passed the New Deal, establishing basic protections and rights like minimum wage and overtime. But to win Southern support, a deal was struck to explicitly exclude two groups of workers, the farm workers and domestic workers. Why? Because at that time, those workers were primarily African American. As a result, domestic workers for decades have been excluded from the foundational labor laws that many of us take for granted, and we still don't have the right minimum legal rights around discrimination, paid leave, or forming a union. Today, immigrant women, many of whom are undocumented, join Black women in the invisible work of caring for our families and our homes. The single unifying factor about this workforce is that when they go to work, it's in the privacy of someone else's home. These women live in the shadows and work behind closed doors, and we often don't know which homes are workplaces. Payments are in cash, contracts and guaranteed hours are rare. Most domestic workers have no benefits like paid sick days. Home care workers make on average $10 an hour. Human trafficking is a serious problem. And almost a quarter of domestic workers make less than minimum wages. Domestic workers are some of the most vulnerable workers across the country. And domestic work, for the most part, continues to be the under-regulated, under-legislated Wild West region of the economy. There are two major modern trends affecting the domestic care sector, propelling this workforce to be at the center of our national discussion on the future of work. A perfect lens through which to understand the transformation underway. First, demand for care is skyrocketing. Millennials have grown up and are having babies. The boomers are aging and living longer than previous generations. 10,000 people are turning 65 a day, and the overwhelming preference of this generation is to age in dignity in their own homes. The sandwich generation is feeling pressure of managing care at both ends while holding down a job, and more women are working outside the home, either by choice or likely by necessity. If you remember one statistic, it's 5x. Jobs in our sector are growing 5 times faster than overall job growth. This means huge care markets are emerging. And at least for the near future, these jobs can't yet be automated or outsourced. So care jobs are here to stay. The boom is not just in jobs. Biomedical device companies, tech companies, housing developers are all preparing for this monumental demographic change. And so in many ways, the future of work is the future of care. And the future of care is the future of work. The second trend affecting domestic workers is Silicon Valley and venture capital's relentless pursuit to discover the next market that hasn't already undergone modern change, leaving it, in their opinions, ripe for disruption. The previously untouched underground markets of care and cleaning fit this bill perfectly. We've seen the collision of technology and the service economy radically disrupt how people hire taxis and find a place to stay, complete errands, and the colonization of the care markets is already underway. The domestic workforce has long been scattered and disaggregated, so the premise of online platforms is to make it easy for employers to find people to clean or care. So much of the early capital frenzy was tied to imagining the Uber of babysitting and the Uber of house cleaning, though that's been tempered by 2 shutdowns and the lack of a profitability model. At first, I thought platforms were simply aggregating both sides of the market at a scale and pace we'd never seen before. Platforms had amassed hundreds of thousands of users, and in some cases, millions. For an industry like ours, where it's simply been impossible to find and organize workers, maybe this could be a good thing. So I led our movement to establish some of the first labor tech collaborations in the country. My hope was that maybe the aggregation that technology enabled could finally allow us to set fair norms and standards. What a breakthrough it would be to make impact in our industry at scale. It's now a few years later, and we've had time to wait and see how Silicon Valley responds to the responsibilities that come with privatizing our labor market. And all we've seen is platforms optimizing the new model for their customers and investors, with very little attention paid to the experience of workers. Let me show you how. This is Maria. She created her first online profile last year. Though she had wonderful references, finding the right family to work for had always been about luck and the right timing. She had heard that a lot of families were posting jobs online. They said it was easier for them. At first, she thought the app was awesome. It was easy and free. She just posted information about herself and families would contact her. At least that's how it was when it started. A few months later, she began receiving notifications that she needed to buy a membership if she wanted to appear higher in search results. She needed to find a job quickly, and so while it was a lot of money for her, she went ahead and paid for it. But she wondered, why did the company need to charge her when they were already charging the families? They have a lot more money than I do, she thought. Maria was diligent about creating her profile. She had decades of experience and knew what she was worth. But when families began reaching out to her, they wanted to pay her less and off the books. Maria was a bit confused. Her profile clearly stated her minimum. But when she declined, her potential employers felt miffed and decided to leave negative 1-star reviews on her profile. Now, for those of you who are new to working online, your online reviews are everything. It's your lifeline to future work. And these weren't even reviews from people she had worked for. They were reviews from people who wanted her to work for them but were upset that she wouldn't submit to their demands. She had no way to post a counter response or review a family. She was effectively silenced and powerless. The company didn't respond to her complaints, and because they essentially have a monopoly over the online market, they don't have to. There is nowhere else for Maria to go. Maria's story and the hundreds more we heard began eating away at me. It began to feel true that platforms were beginning to codify power imbalances that existed offline and just move them online. I wondered what else was impacted when companies have millions to capture users and disrupt domestic work. Would advertising house cleaning at insanely low prices, $19 flat, further entrench attitudes that domestic work is not worth much? And so while I started out quite optimistic, I'm more worried now than ever. The insatiable thirst for returns is built into how these models work, so much so that domestic workers are now paying you to let them work. This isn't about being anti-technology. It's about who controls the way that we work. And I fear the more venture capital controls the labor markets, the harder it will be to build an economy that works for all of us. These are big dilemmas. And before you label me the queen of gloom and doom, I want you to know that it is possible to create change. We're doing it every day, although it's not easy. And there's no magic bullet. The litany of challenges we face in advocating for this workforce are long, historical, structural, legal, racial, and now technological. But all of that has simply inspired us to be creative and entrepreneurial. And here's what we're doing. Since 2010, our movement has passed our signature piece of legislation, what we call the Domestic Worker Bills of Rights. These close the gaps in the law and create floors in markets where anything has gone for decades. We've won in 8 states in 7 years, including California, New York, and right here in Massachusetts. As labor markets digitize, it may mean that we need to continue this strategy of establishing legal floors, but figuring out how to do it online. The technology we're seeing today rarely focuses on workers. To meet that gap, we've established our innovation lab, which I head up, where cleaners and coders, nannies and social entrepreneurs come together to build technology. We see value where others don't, and we've launched exciting new digital solutions like Contracts for Nannies, a TurboTax-type tool that guides nannies and their employers through a series of questions and spits out a legal work agreement. We use the techniques of behavioral economics and social psychology to offer tips that address the problems workers have told us about for decades. And we've joined forces with Google to embed translation so that language is not an obstacle to creating a fair contract. Our lab also launched Aaliyah, the nation's first portable benefits platform, a hot solution idea. Aaliyah allows for house cleaners to receive micro contributions from their clients into a benefits fund. What we've learned is that many employers want to do the right thing. They simply don't know how. Aaliyah provides a trusted, centralized technological mechanism that pools the funds and allows workers to choose which benefits they want, paid sick days or disability insurance, for example. Building our own technology is powerful. And an industry impossible to regulate such as ours, it may have greater impact than the laws we've changed, if we can get to scale. We're also experimenting with ways technology can help us in our impossible task of finding domestic workers. For years, everyone told us that organizing this workforce is impossible, and it's true. But finding people on Facebook and engaging with workers over text is a new way to connect workers with each other and bring them into our movement. And lastly, but perhaps most important, is our rich body of work to transform the way domestic work is viewed. We're working with Hollywood and Silicon Valley to visibilize the invisible. So much of why this work is devalued is because it is seen as women's work. We often say that there is no unlikely ally in the work to win dignity. So you'll find our team working with everyone from movie producers to Airbnb, screenwriters to product engineers on how we can promote fair norms and novel storylines to respect all work. In the last few years, changes in the way we work has meant heightened interest in labor conditions, workplace safety, worker rights and protections, access to benefits. This isn't because we suddenly became more conscious of the invisible workforce like domestic workers, but because venture capital began disrupting the way labor is found, bought, and sold. Until recently, you mentioned Silicon Valley and employee benefits, and you'd conjure up images of free lunches, commuting in a luxury coach, unlimited leave, and free massage in your office. Silicon Valley was creating the high water mark for how workers could be treated when they were truly valued, and money was no object. But then came the gig economy, and a disparity between two workforces became increasingly troubling. While the workers building platforms enjoyed one tier of treatment, gig workers didn't receive healthcare, grappled with tax bills, and insurance implications of not being an employee. Suddenly, Silicon Valley was one of the best and one of the worst places to work. This gap between workers above the API and below the API mimics the gap between workers of the formal economy and the informal economy, like domestic workers. And if you want to see where the future of work, what the future of work looks like, pay attention to the future of domestic work. They are the canary in the coal mine for all of us. Futurists tell me that they expect the platforms of today to evolve into the operating system for labor markets of the future. But if we believe labor markets are public goods, that labor markets are not private property, then we may be in trouble. The last major change to worker conditions, the laws that were passed in the 1930s, had a transparency that is missing today. This change to work, however, is not transparent. We aren't privy to the algorithms that dictate who gets a job and who doesn't. We aren't shared in the debate around what workers should be paid by platforms. Instead, it's a very small group of people driving and funding this major change to work. If we allow venture capital to drive the development of private online labor markets, we're going to see monopolies get created, like we're already seeing, where one company can control and set the standards for an entire workforce. When venture capital is funding monopolization, what can workers like Maria do when their working conditions are unfair? How can she reasonably be expected to hold her own against companies that are selling her services at a loss to gain market share? How can we build a future where technology can be a liberating force? How can we avoid the trap of simply shifting offline inequality online? How can we build a future that includes all of us? Driverless cars are here to stay. So too is the future of work. We should be as concerned about who is writing the future of work and for whom as we are about seeing a car driving around without anybody behind the wheel. Because someone is always behind the wheel, whether we can see them or not.
I'm going to ask you just one question before you leave. You talked about the number of domestic workers just really, there's a huge increase, aging the population, all sorts of things. And you also talked about this work being heavily women, heavily immigrant. Do you see any signs that that's changing as the number of jobs in this sector expands? Are we just looking for like more women to fill those jobs, or like might men also fill those jobs, for example?
I mean, I really think it depends on how we shape the future of this industry. I think some of it will depend on, as Andy had mentioned, immigration reform and whether we open up opportunities. And I think if we can actually transform care jobs to be good jobs, if we can say that this work deserves value and is an important part of the economy, I think we will see people enter the profession. But I think at this point, given the low wages, and if you talk to people who are looking for care, it's hard to find someone.
Yeah, great. Thank you so much. Last, we're going to have Kristen come up and sort of bring these two pieces together, and then we'll all sit down and talk together of workers, technology, visions of the future, and what you found. So take it away.
Thank you, and thanks very much for having all of us here today. Such a great discussion to have with a group that's thinking about innovation. I have to say I'm impressed by both Andy and Palak's discussions, in part by Palak's, because it's a vision of doom and gloom that I haven't heard before in the future of work, and that's something that doesn't come up that often. In the Shift Commission, which is a joint project of New America and Bloomberg, we looked at bringing together both the trends of the economic factors that are affecting our workforce today and the stories and the ways that people talk about the future of work. And we did it specifically because there's this dichotomy between how people in the tech work talk about the future of work, where there's a real vision and the view that there's no problem that tech can't solve and that we'll always create more jobs, that technologies as they develop will morph the way people work in different ways, but it won't take away the fact of having work. In contrast, where I live and work in Washington, D.C., most politicians and people in policy very much think that the robots are coming for our jobs and that that's a negative vision and something that we should fear. So our goal in SHIFT was to think about the ways that we can picture the future of work in different ways 20 years from now, and to examine the impact of automation, AI, other emerging data-connected systems, and how that interacts with the workforce. We had participants in the tech world, the business world, politics, culture, and we tasked them with using the technique of scenario planning, economic scenario planning, which generally comes from the national security world and has historically been used to game out what happens if a particular scenario comes to bear. What happens if North Korea suddenly bombs the city of Washington, D.C., which when we first started talking about this wasn't a realistic possibility. And we brought together participants to think about that and to start envisioning what we think the future of work might look like. We did it in cities around the country, and we did it with people who are both leaders of their fields and who are working in particular fields, and asked them to think through the future of work based on a few specific conditions. One, do we think that we'll have more work or less work as a result of technologies changing our options? And two, do we think that that work will be in the traditional way that we think about jobs, where you go to a specific place for a specific rate of pay and a specific time frame with a set goal in mind? Or do we think that it'll become more project-based and more task-based? And when people got together to talk about these things, they came up with a variety of different things. World one looked something like an advanced farmer's market, where people reverted to thinking about their areas of expertise, craft, or care, or curated experiences, or things that related to the natural world in some way, and use those experiences to do things that only humans can do to interact with one another. We looked at a situation in which there was less work, and it was mostly in job format, which tended to look something like corporations having more power and there being more competition for the few jobs that were out there. We looked at a situation in which there was lots of work, that technology created new opportunities all the time, and that it was in a constantly revolving portfolio of things, kind of like a souped-up version of the on-demand economy that people could access on a regular basis, so whenever or however they wanted to work could choose those things to work on. And we looked at a sort of tech-enabled world where there was constant data connectivity and people were using the different kinds of data connectivity to analyze the landscape and provide the vision going forward. The most important and interesting part of the discussion wasn't necessarily what visions people came up with for the future of work. It was the insights that were common across all three or all four different scenarios. And the first was that most of the emerging opportunities in some form or fashion were self-directed. People had to identify new and emerging kinds of jobs, figure out how to connect with the trainings for them, figure out how to make themselves have a value add that had to do with that kind of work, and prove it publicly. And the human ingenuity was the thing that sort of connected people's ability to find, seek, and identify the work. Secondly, the U.S. education system isn't focused on this kind of iterative, constantly changing, finding a new piece of information and figuring out how to go with it in the way that we think about work. And thirdly, we talk to people over and over again about what they liked and didn't like about the scenarios that people had pictured. And we found repeatedly that the number one thing that people say that they want in a job, whether it's tech CEOs or workers in as taxi driver or elder care worker, the number one thing that people want in a job is economic stability. They want to know when they'll be paid and that they'll be paid a year from now, 6 months from now. They don't want to be constantly searching for the new thing. And so the question that we came to is, how do you create a sense of economic stability in a world where lots of things are constantly in flux and work is constantly in flux? The most frequently asked questions that we got from our groups as we brainstormed different futures were, how do you train people to be entrepreneurial? If we're moving into a world where people have to seek and identify the kind of work that they want to do and create the stories about why they'll be good at those things, how do we wrap that into our high school, apprenticeships, our various community and four-year college education systems? How do we think about, in all ways, how people can be innovative and sort of think through a new approach when they're working? Secondly, what are the benchmarks of advancement in a world where lots of things are changing? If there are more and more people that have work that is not traditional in some form or fashion, how do you demonstrate that you're getting better at it? How do you demonstrate that you're the expert in it? And how do you advance in something that is a one-to-one ratio rather than working in a corporation or corporate setting? How do you create the conditions that allow people to take risks? If people are seeking economic stability, and many of the emerging types of work are flexible and more in flux, what kinds of things, what kinds of products, services, ways of working, policies need to be put in place in order to create the kind of stability that people want? How do you identify what something, what kind of work is worth the opportunity cost that workers have to do to train for it? How can cities diversify and create the kind of vibrancy that they want to see so that they have an ecosystem of innovation and an ecosystem of new kinds of work that's constantly evolving in their community? If we are thinking about non-traditional ways of work and don't have the sense of community that a workplace often creates, what creates the sense of community and identity that goes with a job traditionally? And how do you sort of create the systems that work with that? When we had our brainstorming groups of people envisioning the future of work, we brought people in from lots of different cities, and one of them that was particularly enthusiastic about thinking about the future of work was the city of Louisville. And this is the rundown of the most common jobs in Louisville today. Administrative, office support, production, which is primarily manufacturing, transportation and logistics, sales, and food service constitutes 55% of the workforce in Louisville today. And so thinking about, and those are jobs that are often routine and are ripe for potential changes as a result of automation and artificial intelligence. So what can cities do to start thinking about building on the industries that they already have in their area and morphing those industries so that they're ahead of the curve and have opportunities to get people and funnel people into new opportunities? And then finally, how do you create a long-term vision that focuses on opportunities rather than challenges? How do you get to a point where the relevant pieces and networks are created so that people don't feel disconnected from the kind of work that they are used to doing and the kind of community that they're used to having as a result of it? We found over and over again that workforce education boards, community colleges, four-year colleges, networks of small businesses all have existing networks among themselves, but within a place don't have the networks between themselves to have a conversation about the totality of the future of work. So we're not seeing a situation where places are working together to sort of think through in advance what they see as the best future and trying to put the policies in place to make that a reality. I think the challenge for the next 20 years is to start thinking about the mismatch between what kinds of jobs we see today and how those things are changing, and being able to picture, articulate, and tell a story about what we're moving towards. We found over and over again in talking to people that workers in particular said, I'm interested in training for something new, or I would do it potentially if I knew what the outcome was, but I don't know how it relates to the skills I have, and I don't know what job title to search for or to try to create. So there's a distinction between what kinds of things might be feasible as jobs 20 years from now and the skills that we are talking about today. Secondly, how do you build this individual capacity and empower people to take risks so that they are thinking about new ways to work and to search for work? And finally, what do you do to make sure that it isn't just people who are currently in a job, but anybody who wants to transition a job, get into the workforce anew, value paid and unpaid work, value any both technologically oriented and human-oriented work, and sort of create a system where there are opportunities for all.